Hello, I'm Marc Crosby. Welcome to State View, a program that looks at various issues, various topics, and helps you to stay informed. There are topics really that are focused on the state level, and they obviously filter down to you here living in the city of Quincy or wherever you live. This is certainly a topic that we are covering today, is tobacco legislation, tobacco issues with the new e-cigarettes and so on. And that really is knowledge that you could all benefit from. So sharing today's show with me, across the table from me, is the senator from the Plymouth and Norfolk County. That's John Keenan. John, welcome back.
Thanks, Marc. Always great to be here.
Pleasure to have you. Next to me is Allyson Perron, Government Relations Director for the American Heart Association.
Thank you so much for having me.
Welcome. Thank you. And next to her is Marc Hymovitz. He is the Director of Government Relations for the American Cancer Society Cancer Action Network.
Thanks for having me today.
Welcome,
Mark.
All.
Thank you.
So I guess the best way to start is to probably start by asking, why was legislation necessary? What's the current state? And I don't know who wants to address that first. We're looking at tobacco. Obviously, it's an issue, especially with younger folks and high schoolers, middle schoolers. And I guess, John, talk about why the legislation was necessary.
We were hearing from parents, teachers, school administrators, and we were seeing that, and I was hearing from my own children, for instance, that many of their peers were vaping, using electronic cigarettes. And so we started to look into it a couple years ago, and you could see that the use was growing. Massachusetts had been for a long time one of the national leaders in curbing youth cigarette use. Trend was down, down, down. And then all of a sudden, about 3 years ago, e-cigarettes were introduced, and the trend has been completely reversed. We've lost any progress that we made in combating tobacco use, and now a whole new generation is getting addicted to nicotine and the dangers that are associated with the products that are out there. So we were hearing it from a lot of sources, and to the point where now we know that about 20% of high school students are using e-cigarettes on a fairly regular basis. And that's alarming compared to where we were with tobacco. So it's an industry that is targeting and preying on young people to get customers for life, and this legislation would ban flavors, which is what the industry is using to attract young people to their products.
So, Allyson, would we say that there's a different perception of what's being utilized now?
Yeah, I think, you know, most kids, and these are really untraditional kids that would never have been picking up a traditional combustible cigarette. A lot of student athletes that would instantly say, I would never smoke a cigarette, but are using vape products because they don't think they are harmful for them. And they contain a highly addictive chemical of nicotine. In particular for your heart, it is very bad. It restricts your arteries. It certainly could send younger kids into cardiac arrest, be at higher risk for heart attack and strokes.
So certainly long-term effects.
And we don't really know the long-term effects. They haven't been around long enough to have done enough research. We certainly see some fairly alarming short-term effects on it. And I think because people think they don't have tar and carcinogens in them, which we don't even know if that's true, that they don't have the same effects as a traditional cigarette.
And likely, you know, when could reports surface about the long-term effects?
Yeah, I think we're starting to see some of that stuff come out now. There was just a recent report on the long-term effects on heart on that, and I would imagine that we'll start to see some more of that on the cancer side as well.
And Marc?
Yeah, we still don't know the long-term effects, but, you know, 60, 70 years ago, we gave the big tobacco industry the benefit of the doubt that these products wouldn't be harmful, and we now know that they were harmful. We don't want to give them the benefit of the doubt again. They're already, as the senator said, they're already hooking a new generation on their products, which are very addictive. There probably will be long-term impacts, but we know that the short-term impacts are dangerous enough that it's an epidemic that we do need to deal with now.
Just following up on both of those, the studies are starting to come out. And most of the studies now are suggesting that there are concerns and increased risk, and calling for further studies to determine exactly what the dangers will be. There was a study that was put out by the American Journal of Preventive Medicine in August of 2018, I think it was, that showed an increased risk for cardiovascular, particularly myocardial infarction, and with people who are using e-cigarettes each day. And it suggests an increased risk. So there should be additional studies to show exactly what that increase is and the likelihood of those type of things occurring. And children are just walking into this unaware. Young people walking this unaware that there are dangers.
I do want to call to attention what is currently on the screen. 1 in 5 high school students in Massachusetts are using e-cigarettes, 6 times the rate of adult use.
Yeah, no, that number is alarming, but it's also from 2017. So we know that the newer data that we'll probably get in the next couple of months are going to show even a significantly higher number than that. So it's very concerning.
And one of the points on that slate was also the issue of the flavored, of the flavors, because clearly, I would say adults aren't too concerned with flavors in things so much as kids are really attracted to the flavors. And some of these flavors, even the names of the flavors, seem to be aimed more toward a younger generation.
Yeah, cotton candy, apple teeny, creme brulee, like it's things that certainly seem to be targeted at kids. If an adult is using this product to quit smoking, I don't think that they need cotton candy to do that.
Good point.
Yeah, that's one of the things that we hear often is that from different segments that, oh, this is helping adults transfer or switch from smoking regular cigarettes to e-cigarettes, which may be less harmful. And we'll just kind of leave that argument as it is. In that process of that occurring, though, and it was up on the last screen, you do have young people using it 6 times the rate of adults. So you have a group of adults and a group of young people. And for an adult that moves into e-cigarette use, there are 6 times as many young people who are starting e-cigarettes that weren't smoking. And so the marketing that's being done by the industry is clearly targeted at young people with the idea that they will hook them and have them for life. And if you ask most people who have smoked cigarettes most of their lives, they'll tell you, I started when I was 16, 17,
right.
But certainly under the age of 21. That's when I started, and they had me for life.
We do have a graph on the screen, so possibly you could explain that just a bit.
Yeah, and this goes to what the senator was talking about earlier, that we had made incredible progress in reducing the number of youth that were using combustible cigarettes, and that chart shows it, but now it's reversing. As you can see, the huge increase in vaping and e-cigarette use amongst kids, and again, that number is only going to go higher once we get the latest data. So we need to reverse that trend, and banning flavors is a big step towards that.
And just the previous screen had bright colors too, which are very attractive.
Yeah, they're made to look like candy. They're made to, you know, certainly mimic something that would be attractive to someone younger and certainly a child. So I think, you know, the marketing is very similar to what we saw probably 20 years ago from Big Tobacco. I think to go back to Mark's point, you know, we gave a benefit of doubt to an industry 50 years ago that we should never have. And we certainly should not be giving any benefit of the doubt to this new vape industry as well. It's the same as Big Tobacco. Big Tobacco has invested in this product in order to hook a new generation. When you see the rates going down, they knew that they were going to lose a whole customer base.
Yeah, Juul controls about 75% of the market presently, and Big Tobacco has made about a $13.5 billion investment in Juul. So for people who say, well, this isn't Big Tobacco, this is a whole different industry, this is an industry that's trying to do some good, the tobacco industry wouldn't be investing as they are unless they had a motive, and the motive is to reverse their downward trend in cigarette use and put it into e-cigarette use.
And you say Juul, and folks, kids are often using that term as one would use the term Kleenex for tissues.
Yes. Right.
Yeah, it's the popular brand of choice amongst kids. From in 1 year, their sales exploded over 600%. Over 600%. And they're clearly increasing their market share by targeting kids, and the last two screenshots that you showed are showing, you know, the bright flavored packages that look like candy, as Allyson said. The previous screen had some vaping e-cigarettes that had Marvel comic
superheroes. Yeah, if we could get that image back on the screen, but that was amazing.
Yeah, and if there's any adult smokers that are watching, I'm guessing that not many of them are using those products, but that's how the industry is targeting kids again.
And one of the things that they did was some of the early products, they looked like USB devices for computers. So if a parent walked into a room and saw this hooked into a computer where it was getting re-energized or charged, rather, they would have no idea that it was anything other than something to do with the computer. and yet it's a vaping device that's being recharged to be used. And so just the fact that they were manufactured in that way so that I believe parents wouldn't be able to detect them and the kids could get away with using them and using then the flavors that were clearly targeted at them, that accounted for the 600% increase in Juul's sales.
I think it's not traditional. It doesn't look and it doesn't smell and it doesn't taste like a traditional cigarette. And so many parents don't even know their kids are using this. There was a recent story told by a local pediatrician who said a 10-year-old had been using this product for 3 months and ended up in the ICU with a respiratory illness. And the mom had no idea. The child is 10. Like, they, you know, and you can't tell me that they didn't take this product because of how it was marketed and what the flavoring was and how exciting it was to, you know, every kid wants to do something that has cotton candy or Sour Patch Kid in it. That sounds delicious to them. And so I think, you know, it is truly, I think it's 80% of kids had said that the only reason they use this product is the flavors. I mean, it is a true targeted, you know, opportunity by the industry to hook these kids.
And the FDA in 2009 banned flavored cigarettes, combustible cigarettes, and their reason for doing so was exactly this, that they knew that the tobacco industry was targeting kids with these flavors. So now it's just a newer product, but it's just as addictive, if not more, and we've got flavored products that they're targeting kids with, so we need to ban those.
I do just want to get that image that was on the screen just moments ago back on so we could discuss a little bit about this. Not a safe alternative. Again, we talked about the health risks. Yep. You had spoke about the child.
Yeah, so I think, you know, we certainly are going to start to see more cardiovascular issues in the young develop as well as respiratory illnesses, right? So if a child already has a respiratory illness like asthma, you know, it's going to just increase it and it's going to be harder and harder to kind of control those illnesses. You know, we certainly don't want to see more cardiac arrest in the young or more strokes in the young. We already are combating that as it is. And these products, because of the amount of nicotine and what it does to the arteries and to the heart, it's really concerning. And I think in addition, we are also seeing an uptake in kids switching and being dual users and using traditional cigarettes as well. So where we're down to about a 6% number, I think we're going to go more up to 7 or 8%. And we haven't seen an increase in youth, you know, using traditional combustibles in a very long time. And so I think, you know, it's concerning, you know, for many reasons. In particular, the health ones are huge.
And if I can just follow up on the screen, it mentions anxiety. Talking to teachers, principals, and superintendents of the school districts in the area that I represent, they focused on the issue of anxiety. And they know that children have enough anxiety to deal with as it is, students have enough anxiety, and that they don't need the anxiety that comes with using these products. In some ways, it's a stimulant, and it creates more anxiety. And now there's the anxiety of they're starting to realize that they may be dangerous, but they're addicted. So it's the anxiety of trying to continue to use them without being caught in the schools. And the school administrators and teachers believe that kids are using e-cigarettes at home more than they were, or outside of school, to kind of hide it. And that's adding to the anxiety levels. And it's becoming a real problem that they have to deal with in school. They have students who are getting sick because they've got too much nicotine in the system, not enough. Students who are anxious about the product being used and how they can hide the use. They've got athletes who are using the product now. So it's just something that the schools are really struggling with. They know it's a big, big problem.
And currently on the screen is the 2009 FDA ban on flavored cigarettes.
Yeah, and it made sense then because the FDA took it on because they knew that the industry was targeting kids, as I was saying. So there's no reason why we shouldn't take the same action now with these newer products that are clearly targeting kids with those candy flavors that Allyson was talking about, bubblegum. They're clearly targeting kids, so we need to take the same action that the FDA took back then. And the FDA is not going to do it right now, so the Senator's bill will hopefully accomplish that.
And the action back then showed the appeal of flavors. And when they were banned, the impact was, among many other reasons, but an important reason for the decline in cigarette use by young people afterwards was because the flavors were banned. So there was a level of use due to flavors. Flavors were banned, use declined. The industry saw that, so we can't allow that to keep happening. What can we do? Well, we'll have a new product with flavors, and off that went.
I do want to bring on the screen a graph that really deals with high school students. And right before the show got started, I had mentioned that my son is an athlete, and there was, I believe, one or two kids on his team that were suspended because of vaping. So if we could get that chart on screen and then talk about this chart regarding high school.
We're hearing it a lot. I think, you know, we are hearing from athletic directors and superintendents, and athletic directors, they're getting suspended across the board. We heard from a recent high school grad who got suspended for 5 games and lost his captainship and then lost the opportunity for scholarships and recruitment because he was so addicted to this product. And I think, you know, these are not the traditional kids. They would likely never pick up a cigarette, and they know the cigarette is bad, but they think, well, everyone's doing this, it must be okay. And so they are using it. And I think, you know, that trend, that those numbers from that graph are really scary on how high they're going up. But we're, in addition to high school, we're seeing them as young as in middle school and elementary school.
Well, you had mentioned a 10-year-old.
10-year-old. Yeah. 10-year-old who ends up in the ICU.
Right.
I met with a group of students in Holbrook, and they expressed their concerns about what was happening to their peers, that they were being targeted and taken advantage of. And there was an eighth grader there who said he was worried about himself and his peers, but he was more worried about his younger brother. So an eighth grader more worried about his younger brother being targeted with these products.
Well, it's, you know, they're targeting kids of all ages now, and what's insidious is not just the target of kids, but it's the development of the products too. So a product like Juul contains nicotine, but it also contains something called a nicotine salt, which makes it absorb into the bloodstream faster and hook these kids quicker. And then coming back to the athletes, so they're addicted, they're getting suspended, missing games, missing opportunities to play and advance in their sport. Many of them want to quit, but because it's such an addictive product, they can't quit. And schools are struggling with that now because, you know, at first they were suspending kids from class, suspending them from sports, but then they realize, okay, well, the kids just go home and smoke or vape. But they need help quitting the product. So they're struggling with that now, suspension versus punishment versus actually getting them the help they need to quit.
And there was never a need before for such a cessation device for someone under 18 because we didn't see people getting addicted that quickly at that young of age. And so I think there's many different pediatricians that are really struggling with what the answer is to be able to go back and get these kids off of nicotine because they're getting so addicted so quickly. On the screen it says one Juul pod equals a pack of cigarettes, and I just don't think people understand that. It would be really difficult for a child to sit down and smoke an entire pack of cigarettes in one sitting. You just, from your throat perspective and just being able to have that happen, and you'd also be like, wow, that's a lot of smoking. But you could sit in one setting and do a whole Juul pod, you know, even if it took you, you know, a couple hours. Because of the flavoring, it wouldn't irritate you as much. Very similar to when you think about cigarettes and menthol cigarettes, that anesthetizes your vocal cords. And so it's easier to consume the large quantities of it. That's the same idea that the flavors do in these e-cigarettes and vape products.
I was going to ask, what are some of the campaigns out there that are educating folks about the dangers?
So the Department of Public Health has put out a campaign both on social media and through the schools to target both the kids as well as the parents. I think for us, we've been wildly successful in Massachusetts in bringing down smoking rates, but we've also woefully underfunded the tobacco control program. And so now we're in an epidemic standpoint where we don't have as much foothold in the schools and being able to outreach to parents. And so I think critical funding to make sure that we are doing this education, making sure it's getting out there is, you know, I think as we started working on these pieces of legislation, we heard from so many parents that didn't even know that this was a problem.
And we've got decades of evidence to show how to reduce youth tobacco use, and it was successful. So we're trying to replicate some of those, including banning flavors, including funding the state's tobacco control program. We're also looking, our coalition's looking at adding an excise tax to these products, which there is not now, to make it somewhat equal with the tax on cigarettes, because we know one of the most effective ways to keep kids from starting is to increase the price, since they're price sensitive. So just trying to recreate a lot of those things, the evidence-based strategies that we used to counter cigarettes, to do the same thing here.
And young people are stepping up as well. There's the 84 movement, there's other groups that are organizing of students who are seeing what's happening among themselves, to their peers, and are really, really concerned about it. And they're doing some incredible work to push back on the industry. And their message to the industry is not our generation. You've gotten other generations addicted to your products. We're not going to let it happen to our generation. And the risk of doing nothing is to have another generation addicted to a dangerous nicotine product.
I did notice as I was reviewing the Senate's budget, the excise tax applied to e-cigarettes.
Yeah, again, it proved incredibly effective at reducing youth cigarette use and tobacco use. And we've got one of the highest cigarette taxes in the nation. We've got the highest taxes on what's called other tobacco products like chewing tobacco. And that's been very effective. So in addition to banning flavors, which we know will be very effective, we also are trying to increase the price to keep them out of the reach of kids.
Yeah, the price is a key component of it, but it's complementary to the banning of the flavors because many of the young people are buying these products from older peers. They're selling them out of backpacks. And so for them, because this is a unique product, because it's not a typical combustible product, and because the age has now been increased from 18 to 21, there may be less of an impact on by way of the tax. And so we want to make sure that we get to what is really attracting them, which is the flavors. So the combination of the tax and the flavors, and then we have to follow it up with cessation programs as well. It will be the best holistic way to attack the problem.
I do want to get a graphic on the screen if we could. It is from the Truth Initiative. It says youth ages 12 to 17 who report flavoring is a primary reason for using a tobacco product.
Yeah.
That slide right there should be enough evidence to as a reason to ban the flavors. I mean, clearly that's what's attracting kids to these products.
No matter what kind of tobacco product you use, it's certainly because of the flavors. Right. But as you can see, e-cigarettes is the highest. And, you know, I think in the vape products and the e-cigarettes is the most flavor availability. There's over 8,000 different types of flavors.
8,000.
You name it, they have it. If you're a young person who has a particular...
I don't think there's enough. There are as many flavored waters, because that's right. The big thing now with beverages. And 8,000?
Yeah, someone said to me, there's not 8,000 flavors of ice cream. How do they have 8,000 flavors of cigarettes,
there's
right?
There's a flavor for every
but
kid.
But there's a flavor for every kid.
I need to ask how simply the idea of smoking has changed, because we now have recreational marijuana use in Massachusetts. So what's the perception? How has that maybe impacted e-cigarettes?
I can tell you what the schools are telling us, the leaders in the schools. They were bracing for the issues associated with the legalization of marijuana. They expected that to be the next big thing that they would have to deal with. And as they were preparing to deal with that, this came out of nowhere and just took over. So they are allocating their resources to addressing this. They do have a concern that the idea of vaporizing, vaping, which is a very nice thing, you know, sounds very nice, but it's aerosoling, bringing aerosol into your lungs. But they're concerned that that will become normalized. And then once that's normalized, that these devices will be used for the delivery of THC, perhaps. But they're really focusing on the e-cigarettes presently, how they're being normalized, and just trying to deal with it. So this idea of ingesting things, inhaling things, is becoming much more common.
And when you say vaping, when you use the word vape, a lot of folks just think of water, something harmless,
but
as
it's
a
not,
vapor.
There's no water.
It's not
no
water. You know, we know there's chemicals in there, some cancer-causing chemicals that are in there. And again, we don't know the long-term effects yet, but we know there are known cancer-causing chemicals in there, but it's not water.
Right. And as a child who is comparing that to smoke, they may think, you know, it can't be that bad. It can't be
as
bad.
I certainly think that is happening, that kids think this is a better alternative, and you will certainly hear that, and they'll talk a lot about harm reduction and the importance of that. But I think to go back to the fact that if for every adult that uses this product, 6 kids use it, that isn't harm reduction. You can't have a whole new generation getting hooked to something and call it harm reduction. And is there a possibility that it's less harmful than the most dangerous product in the market? Maybe. But it's still not good for you. That still doesn't make it okay to use or not harmful. It might make it less harmful than something with tar and carcinogens, but it doesn't make it that there aren't any bad effects to it.
I'd be upset and worried if my son was driving 120 miles an hour. I'd be upset and worried if my son was driving 90 miles an hour. 90 miles an hour isn't any better than 120 in the grand scheme.
Right.
And so, you know, you can look at this as e-cigarettes, as regular cigarettes is 120 miles an hour. We know it's dangerous. We know there's an increased likelihood of something happening. 90 miles an hour isn't a whole lot safer.
That's a good
And it's
analogy.
Still dangerous.
Right. And going back to it, these are kids that never would have picked up a regular cigarette, so it's not harm reduction for them. You know, you're starting off with that less dangerous product, but still dangerous. So, you know, that's been the fundamental issue with these products, is they're targeting kids who never would have picked up a combustible cigarette.
And I think we talked a lot about tobacco and over the years, and less about the nicotine, and the nicotine is still the issue in these products.
And I just want to take a moment, if I can, to talk a little bit about what the pushback has been on the legislation, because I think parents have to be aware of it. They're going to hear that this is not a harmful product, and the studies are starting to accumulate to show that it is. They're going to hear that this is a smoking cessation device, that it's helping smokers. The industry has made a conscious decision not to have this regulated as a smoking cessation device. They have made that decision. They don't want to be regulated because they know that their product would not meet the standards for smoking cessation. So parents will hear this, oh, this helps people get off of cigarettes, and maybe it does. But there's a study out there that shows, in fact, that if somebody that switches from combustible cigarettes to e-cigarettes, they don't stop using e-cigarettes. They continue to use e-cigarettes because they're addicted to them. You're also going to hear the argument from the markets that, oh, local convenience stores, this means jobs, and they're going to do a real good job of policing the sale of these products. But the history shows that they haven't. When you look at the numbers of adult individuals who are using e-cigarettes versus young people using e-cigarettes, if we eliminate the young people, they're gonna, you know, flavors, they're going to say, oh, our store is going to close. But yet we're only selling to adults. It's clear what's going on here. Young people are buying these products. And the retail stores are going to say it's online retailers. And online retailers are going to say it's the retail stores that are selling it. It's both. And that's why the ban, the comprehensive ban on flavors, has to be put in place, that we don't get one playing off the other. So you're going to hear all these things. And Juul is already out there touting that it's a good corporate citizen, that they support increasing the age to 21 across the country. Their marketing over the years shows what their real intent is, and their real intent is young people getting the hook so they have customers for life.
I want to thank you certainly for joining me today and getting this information out there. Again, we will utilize this on our television channels as well as our website, and you're certainly encouraged to share this as well, this particular program. A lot of great information given out today. So thank you, Allyson. Thank you, Marc. And thank you, John.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And thank you at home for watching. You have been watching a program of Quincy Access Television. Please continue to watch QATV for more locally produced programming.